All right, welcome back to the channel, Packet Heads, and I thought in this video we could take a closer look at sequence and acknowledgement number analysis. Now, I know that this is a tedious topic, I know it can be confusing, but the more practice you get at it, the better you're gonna be with analyzing TCP flows with Wireshark. So, let's go ahead and get into it. Now, as always, you can click the link in the description down below, and that will get you to the trace file that you can use to follow right along. Now, sequence and acknowledgement number analysis. I've talked about these topics separately in different videos, and you can find those up here, one for sequence numbers and the other for acknowledgement numbers. But what I'd like to do in this video is give you more practice of how to do this practically with Wireshark. So go ahead and pop open this example and you can follow right along. Now this was the same trace file that I used in a previous video. We looked at this when we were analyzing some retransmissions. But key to understanding those retransmissions is knowing how sequence and acknowledgement numbers work. So let's go ahead and take a closer look. Right here I'm in my TCP basic profile in Wireshark. That's about to change. I'm gonna show you a few adjustments you can make to make sequence number analysis a little bit easier on yourself. But key to this is understanding I have a TCP segment length column here. Now, in the handshake, this is where I can see this is just empty packets that are accomplishing the goal of establishing a handshake. Here I've got SYN, SYN, ACK, ACK. Those are two endpoints talking to one another. Now, in the SYN, SYN, ACK, ACK, if I just take a look at the SYN, I come down here to sequence number, this is where I can see that Wireshark is giving me a relative sequence number. Basically, what it's doing is it's saying, okay, this big scary looking number here, let's just zero this out just for the purposes of analyzing this thread, and let's act as if this number was zero. Now, why are we gonna do that? Well, remember that every byte I send, I track that using sequence numbers. If I send you 100 bytes, you take the sequence number that I'm using, you add 100, and then that now becomes the acknowledgement number that you use coming back to me. That's how I can tell that you got my 100 bytes. All right, so every byte I send has an associated sequence number. Now, as human beings, we don't do very well with 4-byte huge numbers that look like this. We don't do well starting counting from this number. We like to start counting at zero. So that's why Wireshark just takes this raw sequence number and zeros it out for us. Now, this sequence number is useful in some situations. We'll make sure to cover that on a separate video. But the sequence number at the start, it's nice to look at this as zero. Now, keep in mind, the next sequence number in this direction is going to be one. I send a ghost byte in the handshake. Basically, the other side is going to come back and say acknowledge one, acting as if I had sent a byte of data in that initial SYN. You always see that in every TCP handshake. We basically exchange a ghost byte with the two SYNs. Well, the server comes back and it says, all right, here's my raw sequence number, but Wireshark's gonna zero it out for us and it's going to increment it by one. So by the time we get to the ACK in the TCP handshake, now both sides have exchanged that. We're at sequence one in one direction and sequence one in the other direction. Now as data gets exchanged in each direction, those sequence numbers are going to begin to increase. All right, so a value that's really useful to me as I'm going and doing sequence analysis is obviously the sequence number. So the first thing I'm gonna do, come down, I'm just gonna say right click and I'm going to apply this guy as a column. Also, what's nice to know is my next expected sequence number, that's good to have. So I'm gonna right click and add that guy as a column. And also the acknowledgement number, not the raw, but the relative ACK number. I'm gonna right click that one and add it as a column. So now I can see up here and you can go ahead and follow me in doing that. That's actually great to do for a TCP analysis profile, or maybe you could create a new profile, right click profile up there. What you can do is you can have a whole profile that has these columns so that when you're not doing TCP sequence analysis, you don't have your screen so full of these columns. So in our case, what our goal is to do this analysis. So we're gonna go and leave this alone. All right, so sequence number, next sequence number, acknowledgement number. And in fact, something else that I can do with these header values up here, if I just wanna save myself a little bit of screen real estate, is I can go ahead and right click sequence number. I'm just gonna say edit column, and I'm gonna change the title to SEQ, and then I'm gonna use that number value there, or that number symbol. I'm gonna say okay, and you see how that changes the amount of space I need for that description. So I'm just gonna pull this over just a hair. And I'm just going to do the same. And then find finally the ACK number. Now that I have these, I can buy myself just a little bit more space. And let's go ahead and see how these work together. So first, let's come down to packet 4. I'm starting at sequence number 1. I send to 14. So when I have 2 port 14 plus 1, my next expected sequence number in this direction is 215. The ACK number is still 1 because the other side hasn't sent me anything yet. All right, so within an allotted amount of time, an expected amount of time, I never see an acknowledgement. All right, so what do? Well, I retransmit the same 214 bytes, starting at sequence number 1. 215 is my next expected sequence number in this direction. At the same time, this is the number that I should expect the other side to ACK with. Remember that the other side is going to take my sequence number, add the amount of bytes that I've sent, and that will be the ACK number that they use to come back to me. This is how I know that the receiver got those 214 bytes. They incremented their ACK number. Well, beautiful. That's great. But here's a bit of a problem. You notice what happened with the sequence number here in this response coming from the sender? We just jumped up to 4067. Well, the last time we saw a number in this direction, it should have been 1. This sender hasn't sent anything to us. We don't see any TCP segment lengths of 4067 or anything that would add up to that, because that would be a larger than acceptable frame size. But we don't see bytes that add up to that previous to this. Instead, we just saw a jump to that sequence number. That's why Wireshark goes, whoa, hang on a second, TCP previous segment not captured. We missed something here. It was supposed to be 1, and then we just saw this jump. So what happened to those 4066 bytes? Well, what happens next is you can see that the sender, it waits 2 seconds. Now, there were probably some retransmissions happening on the other side that we didn't get to see. If you want to see more about why we believe that, go ahead and hit this video. This is where we break down those retransmissions in this trace file. But what we're going to do is stick on the topic of sequence analysis. All right, so our sequence numbers are 1 in this case. So this was the packet or bytes that we would expect to see. But this time we just see 536. Now this is a smaller packet size. This is basically the smallest MSS that a TCP is going to try to use before it ditches the connection. So it might have tried a larger segment size and it ran into an MTU issue. And then it just last ditch thought, you know what, I'm going to try to get this thing through. So here's our sequence 1. So 536 plus 1 is 537. All right, so since this packet made it through, the client then increments its acknowledgement number to 537. We receive this packet from the sender. Now notice that this is an empty ACK and the client is not incrementing its sequence number. It hasn't sent anything else since that original 214. So that's why we're going to see 215. We're just going to sit on 215 until the client sends something else. Meanwhile, the other side, the server coming back to us, it sends 537. That was the last expected sequence number for us to start on, 537. We're sending 536. That's how we arrive at 1073 for the next packet. Let our eyes go down there. 1073 plus 536, 1609. Fabulous. If we come down here to the client, it says, great, I'm good to 1609. I have successfully received everything up to 1609. I'm good on those two packets. Wonderful. Let's keep going. Let's go ahead and scroll past this. And here we run into another problem. Our next expected sequence number was 1609. But here we can see the server, it sends 2145. So here we see another jump in sequence number. So this was a gap. It's got this large one, it sends it. And then the next expected sequence number for this direction should be 2681. So the client says, okay, wait a second, pump the brakes. I was at 1609 having a great time, just loving life. And then you went out of sequence again. You jumped ahead and you sent this 536. Now, maybe the packets before that this got lost. Maybe we have a gap here. But let's go ahead and take a closer look. If we come down here, let's go ahead and take a look at the acknowledgement number in packet 13. So this is where the acknowledgement number is 1609. That's the sequence number point that we're good to as a client. But notice that we have a SAC block that's starting to form. So let's go ahead and go down to options. We're gonna expand this. And our TCP option, what this does is it says, okay, I have successfully received 2145 through 2681. I'm good, I got that 536. But I've got a problem here because there's a gap between 1609 and 2145. There's 536 bytes that I'm missing. So you sent me packet 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, but I only got 1, 2, and 4, 5. I'm missing this one that's in the middle. All right, so that's how the client indicates this to the server. Well, the server hasn't even gotten this dupe back yet. It hasn't gotten that SAC block, so it just keeps on sending. So it's just thinking life is continuing on, no problem. 2681 through 3217, there's a 536, there's another 536, and then finally a 314. So this is 3753 to 2067. So now we're up to that original point that we started at. Remember 4067? 4067. This is where the server thought that it was good, but all of this data went missing, likely due to a too large MTU. But if we come down here, so there's the 4067. So our data hasn't yet all cleared out yet because we haven't received everything yet. But let's check this one out. The next packet down is packet 17. There's 1609. This one fills in the gap of our dupac. All right, so our dupac flagged that we had some missing data. It gave us that SAC block. But then if we take a look here, there's a, this fills in that SAC block that's indicated in packet 13. Now, just for me, when I take a look at this, if I take a look at packet 13 and if I look at the delta times, notice that I'm sub millisecond that these packets are coming in, these smaller packets. So these guys were already in flight on the way to the client when the client sent this dupac. So these are basically all sent in sequence, just boom, 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 boom. And the client was like, oh, wait, I missed one of them. But hang on a second. If we come down here, we can see that all of these were sent in succession, but it looks like one of these went out of order, right? Look how fast this was sent. This is sub millisecond. So we didn't have enough time for this dupac to get all the way to the sender and then for the sender to react to that dupac and begin to retransmit. It wouldn't do it after a single dupac anyway, just because something like this can happen where just one goes out of order. So why kick off a retransmission unless things just went a different path or if they got swapped in some kind of way from the server back to the client? Okay, so all the data got there. Now we can see the client clearing itself out. Initially it goes, all right, dupac, okay. And then it goes, oh, wait a second, I did get everything. So packet 20 is the client saying, good, all right. Okay, I see you, server. I'm good all the way to 4067. Thumbs up. We can just continue off with life now. But prior to this, the client actually sent these two other dupacs. It's possible that it was just reacting to packets above our 1609. It was just saying, great, I'm good. Actually, sorry, with the dupac, 1609, okay. If I take a look at my left edge, right edge down in my SAC block, I'm good to 3753. If I take a look at dupac 3, I'm good all the way to 4067. But hey, Mr. Server, I'm missing between 1609 and this left edge. It had already received it, but it's likely that the TCP was already in the process of ACKing that data as it came in. It just hadn't gotten around to ACKing this one yet, which we see happen down in packet 20. So all of our data got there. But here's the thing. This is kind of interesting as well. We sent out three dupacs, dupac 1, dupac 2, dupac 3. What does that do? That's going to trigger a retransmission on the other side. If you only get one dupac with a SAC block, the sender is going to think, why don't I just wait to see if you send me any more dupacs? Because maybe some outstanding data went out there and it just got swapped. That's exactly what happened here. One came in out of order and the client caught up to acknowledging it. But before that happened, we sent three dupacs. That's going to trigger a fast retransmission, which is the whole point of packet 22. The server's like, whoa, you needed 1609 to 2145 again to plug that hole. It's called Spurious. This is another part of Wireshark, fun sequence number analysis. It's called Spurious because this packet was already received and already successfully acknowledged. So it's spurious. It's not really necessary. The data went and we already saw an acknowledgement for that data. So either this was just an extra retransmission that was not necessary, or it's possible that those acts got lost on the way back to the server. That's also a possibility. However, just looking at the flow, we can see that this was indeed spurious. All right, so let's back up a second. Sequence and acknowledgement numbers. It's nice to have a profile like we have here in Wireshark, where we can see the sequence number, the next sequence number, the acknowledgement number, and we can follow these bytes as they flow in each direction. When you're doing sequence and acknowledgement number analysis, you just gotta slow down, just like we did, and just take it packet by packet, watch the flows, and that can help you to better understand and really recreate the event in your own mind. So practice, practice, practice. The more sequence and acknowledgement number analysis you do, the easier it gets, and the faster you can use these columns to figure out what happened on the network. I hope you enjoyed this video and videos like these. Please like, share, subscribe, and of course, leave me a comment down below. Let me know what you thought. And of course, I'm gonna see you on another video. Take care, packet heads.